knots on the wind knot.
Okay. So I guess that brings us tonight to tonight's program. So Chris, you want to introduce our program tonight? And Brian, I believe you can just share your screen when the time comes.
Yeah, tonight we've got a little different topic than we initially started to have with Brian. Brian, I'd asked several months ago if he would do one on steelhead fishing. And then when we talked a few months ago, with a couple months ago, just not that long, he said it'd be probably kind of an academic session because the steelhead just are not coming in. But it looked good for salmon, particularly the coho. And so what he's going to do tonight is give us some information on fishing for not just the cohos, but other salmon out there too. So I appreciate that he made that change. I think it's going to be much more beneficial. Brian is the manager over at the Lake Oswego Orvis store. Maybe some of you have seen him. Well, that's a new store. I have not been in it. But you may have seen him at the store at Bridgeport and may be acquainted with him. So, Brian, and again, if everybody will make sure that they're muted. And Steve Jones, I don't think you are, and your chair likes to have attention. Thank you. Let's see. Brian?
Okay. Let me just switch it to show. Oops. Okay. Everyone seeing it?
Yep.
Okay, and volume's good and everything like that?
Yes, it is for me.
Okay, so one thing I was thinking too before we even start, if maybe, would it be okay if people maybe threw questions onto the chat and then every so many slides we'll take a quick break, and then I don't know if maybe Chris wants to moderate the questions. Does that sound okay, or?
I think I'll just leave it with you and the people with the questions instead of moderating. You know, if you feel it's a good time, just go ahead and.
Okay. Another thing, if I'm going and anybody sees something, you know, wants to know something really interesting and, you know, kind of say, excuse me. But I figured with the pace of the slideshow, we'll be kind of tight if we're really going slow. So anyway, quick introduction. I'm Brian Martz, the fishing manager now at Orvis Lake Oswego. And I don't know how many have been in there, but definitely come and check it out because we have a whole new concept now where we're doing like just full service fly fishing shop and actually even carrying some upland, but a totally different concept. A lot of people have really enjoyed it. And I'm sure everyone at the fly club will be happy to see more of a full service fly fishing shop over there. And cut out all the casual clothing and everything. So that may upset some, but we're just going for what was doing really well at the store. So anyway, and I really appreciate the invite. And as you know, earlier, I was originally going to do steelhead, but with the sad state of the steelhead right now, figure we'll do the salmon fishing. The one thing too, you know, that most of my experience is in Oregon, but the techniques and the species, you know, are going to overlap into Washington. But unfortunately, I haven't really done much salmon fishing in Washington. I've done steelheading on the OP, but so I can't really even chime in on places to go. But nonetheless, you know, I'll talk about how I even find spots and you can utilize that for where you go. So everyone ready to go? Cool. Well, hopefully this will fire everyone up because I could honestly say for the year of fishing, this is one of the things that gets me utterly juiced. I love this fishing. So the topic is going to be fly fishing for Pacific salmon on the Oregon coast. Really, it would be pertinent for both. Just my experience, like I said, is at Oregon. But as far as, you know, feel free to apply all this to Washington. So we're going to be talking about river fishing. And it's going to be anywhere from right, like sort of coming out of the tidewater to a little higher up. You know, the rivers, legal fishing zones vary from some place to place. Some rivers, like the Wilson where I live, you can fish for salmon pretty far up. And certain situations, they'll be bright far up. So a lot of that, you know, depends on precipitation. Then we're going to be doing tidewater fishing. And it's going to be basically waters that'll be influenced by the tides. We're going to cover Chinook. There are both springers and fall, but we're going to focus on the fall run just because that time of the year right now. And then coho, which also are called silvers. And as a lot of you are already aware, they're anticipating, but pretty much already know it's going to happen, a large run this year of both hatchery and wild fish component, because they've been catching those fish out in the ocean all the way from Northern California to Southern Oregon weeks back. Now those fish are already starting to come into our bay, so looking good. And then chum. One thing I thought about when someone was talking earlier, saying pinks, we don't have pinks in Oregon, so unfortunately I don't really have experience with them. So right here, this is going to be an example of a tidewater Chinook right out of the salt. I give the analogy, it looks like when you go to a fish market and you see the frosty ice and there's a fresh Chinook salmon on it, it's going to be of that quality. They're, you know, never going to be serving river dark fish in the you know, food market. So that quality of amazing fish. The Chinook could be identified, I think you guys could probably see my cursor, but right here, black mouse is a name. The other characteristic, I've heard people call them spot backs. They have kind of a little bit more pronounced spots and a heavily spotted back to them. They can be huge. I say it up to 50. And you know, Alaska, they caught them up to 100. The Rogue River fly fishing record is, I think, 74 pounds caught now, probably about 12, 14 years ago or so. But I remember when that was caught. So they can be huge, very strong fish. So here's an example of a Chinook caught up in the freshwater. This was caught probably about like 9 miles above tidewater. Still a very hard fighting fish, but you know, you can see they start kind of bronzing up. Sometimes they turn dark brown, sometimes they turn reddish brown, sometimes they just get moldy. One thing I find is the less, the more they're in the river, the less likely they are to eat your fly. So here we're going to jump to coho, and this is a coho literally caught on the top of tidewater. The spot I caught this fish in, at low tide, it's freshwater flowing. At high tide, it's totally, you know, filled in like a frog water pond with tidewater. It's a really cool spot. Silver in color, hence the nickname silvers. That's what they call them in Alaska. They have white gums on them. This one, let me pull over. I actually have the, so my mouse is kind of hiding, but you can see the gum line on the cohos is white as opposed to black. Not many spots. They will get some dots, but not nearly as polka dotted as a Chinook. And here's one that I've caught in actually the exact same spot as the colored up Chinook salmon. So about 9 miles above tidewater. Some of them get a green head, purpley body. This next picture will show coming up after the more reddish one, but darker colored the longer and fresh. And again, I find less likely to eat a fly as they ripen in the fresh. And the term ripen, I mean, is getting sexually mature for their spawn. So this fish here would be a fish caught up in the sandy with some color on it. It would be very representative of a fish, you know, you can catch like across the river in Washington up on a Columbia tributary when in the river. Again, you can see those bright white gums, not to be confused with the black there. You know, really think about the gums if you're having trouble IDing. This one's got that greenish top, reddish bottom. Still a really hard fighting fish, fun to catch. I would say in this case, you know, you have a hatchery fish, not necessarily the best table fare, probably better to let that one go. A lot of people would say good for the smoker. I find with fall fish, if you're planning on keeping them, if they're not literally bright as a dime, they're usually better to throw back. Here we have a chum salmon. And, you know, one classic thing is the barred striping. I always say zebra stripes. You know, it's very interesting looking fish, big mean teeth. This fish literally, you know, was probably in tidewater hours before. It actually has sea lice all over its back. It's hard to see, but fresh for a chum. The thing about these fish is they ripen as soon as they come into the fresh water. They just immediately think of spawning. In Oregon, Oling available in the Miami and Kilches. Washington, if anyone wants to chime in, how many rivers are legal in Washington? Anyone want to say?
Don't know. There's plenty on the OP, but locally, the rivers that feed the Wallapa Bay tend to have chum salmon.
Legal or not legal?
Legal to fish for. Good. Most people don't keep them because, as you said, they're actually silver in the salt, but if you keep them, you know, they're not good eating.
Yeah, good fisheries in the Hood Canal too.
You know, you see them in the supermarkets, and you're always like, ugh, you know.
Well, they're called dog salmon because the natives used to feed them to their dogs.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, funny to say,
but they're
like,
one of the hardest fighting salmon.
I've eaten some people have brought from Alaska smoked, and it was good, but they said chrome is a dime. But anything in that case could smoke. But yeah, we just catch and release them. Same thing. But yeah, as far as those two rivers I mentioned, the only legal rivers, but I know in Washington, there's quite a bit of rivers that have runs that you can, you know, catch and release fun fish for them. So the thing about chums, I bet a lot of you are already aware of this, but just out there experiencing chum, I see a lot of unethical things. So the thing about it is in regards to the ripening, so they have the urge to spawn quicker than any other salmon. So the moral of the story with that is when targeting them in a river, in the salt, you don't have to worry about this, but only target them in a deep green water. Do not target them in the shallows. One of the bad things I see in a Miami and Kilches, and unfortunately it's fly fishermen doing the worst damage, is trouncing on the reds and just pounding on spawning fish and then taking pictures for Instagram. So that's why I'm kind of adamant about that statement. I'm sure some of you have seen it in your neck of the woods too. You know, and the main point is they're actively spawning or staging the spawn when they're in the shallows. And it's ethically wrong. Just, you know, stay away from them at that point. I think, you know, the funny thing about salmon with a lesser experienced fisherman is that they see big fish on the spawning beds, they just kind of lose their sense of ethics and can go for them. I've seen people go for spawning Chinook, etc. So here's a picture of a chum caught in a salt water zone. Low tide, it could be sort of fresh, but this is literally on the edge of a bay. And like you said earlier, you know, way beautiful fish, very hard fighting fish. Funny thing about this, you can see a big bright pink leech in its mouth. Stereotype of chums or cohos is the big bright pink leech. So anybody have any questions while we're at it? I actually, hold on one sec. Let me see if I can flip to the chat. Yep. Somehow I'm stuck in this mode. Actually, wait, hold on a minute. Okay. The problem is I can't actually see the chat without bailing this. So I would say if anyone has any questions before I start the next section, ask right now on that first part of species.
I'll monitor the chat for you. There are no questions.
So okay, cool. All right. I'll just move on then. Okay. So we'll go on to equipment now. So for equipment, I'm going to talk about different forms, because the one thing that's really challenging with salmon fishing is being at a fly shop, especially people say like, what do I need for salmon? And I'm like, it's a lot more complicated than just giving a quick answer. So in regards to equipment, there's equipment for dead drifting flies. I mentioned here an 8-weight switch rod can do it all, or a single hand 8 to 10 weight. An 8 or 9 weight for coho, 9 or 10 weight for chum or chinook, kind of being a little more specific. I, in the fall, typically will just fish have a 9 weight and a 10 weight, but I'll usually fish like my 10 when I know I'm kind of targeting chinook. I'll fish my 9 if I'm going for any of the above or my 10. That way I'm pretty ready for it all. So as far as dead drifting, long belly fly line, floating line, should have mentioned, don't have that written right there, with a longer rear taper, and it enables good mending, roll casting. an example, a line that we sell is the salmon and steelhead taper, or like the scientific anglers, and it goes all the way through 10 weight. So really, you know, effective for that kind of fishing. And it can be done with like a tight line method. So anybody who is, you know, really into the Euro method of fishing, you can do this. You don't need a strike indicator. I actually did it for years without an indicator before I started using indicators. Strike indicator rigs, extremely productive.
Sorry.
And leader tippet strength, 16 to 20. Hello? Sometimes I would say to people 12 pound for coho, but if you know you're going to catch a coho, chinook, or chum in the same given day, I would say go 16 or 20. I just use 20 myself. The 20 pound fluoro nowadays is so narrow that it's.
So Steve, we have a question about tippet size.
Someone have one?
Tippet size? What is a question about tippet size?
What is it?
What type of tippet?
Oh, I use Mirage fluorocarbon. That's Orvis's brand. You know, I think any kind of, you know, I happen to work there. It's really, really good stuff. I can honestly say not working there, it's my favorite fluorocarbon. But a lot of people love Seaguar too, you know, because just depending on how convenient it is to buy stuff. I personally think, you know, any brand really, as long as it's legitimate 16 to 20 pound, there's some stuff that'll say 16 and it breaks a lot easier. So, I mean, as long as it's true tested stuff, I would say safe, you know, but ironically, I personally really am adamant about fluorocarbon. As much as these fish should not be leader shy, something about the reflection seems to really put them off at times. So, you know, I'm sure everyone's caught them with mono, but I've done way better with fluoro.
I was, wondering if you
another question concerning whether you're fishing frog water or is there some flow when dead drifting?
Yeah, more slotted type of water actually, which I'll kind of talk about in techniques later, but yeah, definitely more like up to downstream moving current, preferably slot water or bottleneck water is what I would consider. And I'll go into that deeper in a little while, but, you know, just to kind of quick answer that.
Super.
I'm not sure your slides are advancing. I don't know.
Oh, actually I haven't advanced one in a bit. I'm stuck there.
Oh, okay.
Okay. No, that's why I just was sticking on that. So now we'll move to the next, you know, part, like swinging / stripping fly equipment. And same thing again, an 8-weight switch rod can do it all. Single hand 8 to 10 weights. So really the same rods for dead drifting as opposed to swing fishing. 8 or 9 weight for coho, 9 or 10 for chum or chinook again. So sinking, shooting tapers, type 1 through type 5, match with intermediate running line. I'll go into that deeper too coming up. Or full intermediate sinking line. So one thing to chime in on, these sinking shooting tapers are pretty much being phased out from about everybody. I nowadays can order, I'll go into this deeper, but I can order the type 1, the type 4, the type 6, the type 1, the type 2, the type 3 are the most important. So if anyone has access and can find them, you know, via eBay and you're into this, I would buy them, because even if you're not going to use them now and use them as backups, they're becoming a hot commodity. So the most important line though is what I mentioned here, full intermediate sinking line. At this point here, when I did this presentation originally, I said a plus. Nowadays, it's really become the main line because these have become so hard to find. And again, fluorocarbon leaders, up to 20 pound tippet for chinook. And I wrote salmon aren't leader shy. I have a coho later you'll see in a video, and I catch it on 20 pounds. So I find when you're swinging stripping flies, since they're not even really seeing the leader because they're seeing the back end of the fly, I find it really, you know, it's better to just go heavy because when they grab it, you have that pounds for the hook set and everything. Here is a picture. This one is a little bit dated, unfortunately, but it's taking a picture of the shooting tapers. I still use them. I don't know if anyone in the group has them, so I definitely like to mention them. You know, here's a 10-weight rod, big reel, saltwater reel, as I mentioned.
Brian, I'm not seeing any pictures. I'm not still not seeing any change in that one slide.
Oh, weird. Wait, hold on 1 second. Let me. Oh, I got it. I apologize. I hit a button. Can you guys see now? Let me.
Yeah.
Okay. Let me back up. Let me actually. I'll just go back to that last. Whoops.
No, I think it's fine. Just keep moving.
And Brian, we're about 15 minutes in right
okay,
now.
Okay, cool. Hold on 1 sec. I just gotta. Not that. Trying to get this thing out of the way. It's right in the way of my view. Hold on 1 sec. I just gotta move this screen for 1 second. Okay, now we got it. Everybody good on there? Can everyone see this slide current?
All I see is a big green screen, and now I see the whole slide.
Okay, all right. So this is the one where I was talking swing and stripping. I'll just leave it up for about 30 seconds if anyone wants to read up on it. Anyone have a question while I'm just leaving this up here? Okay, I'm going to pop it. So here's this one. Everyone can see these little rolls of line on the desk there.
Quick question, Brian. Yes. On those leaders that you're running, how long a leader are you running off of your fly line?
Actually, I'll have a pretty crazy little slide coming up that'll show all the lines. Okay. Yeah, so here's the shooting tapers. Like this would be intermediate for SA, type 2, type 3 Rio. So 10 weight rod, saltwater reel, type 1, type 2, type 3 Rio, type 4 SA, type 5, or actually type 6 SA, intermediate running line, fluorocarbon leader tippet. So I go this route of I have a roll of 30, a roll of 25, roll of 20, and I hand tie, and I'll actually show you guys the details. Oh, one quick thing too. This right here actually rolls of a T14 for really big water. I'm just so into it. I have just about everything, you know, but backing up a little way. So this is what I would say is the most modern current line that everyone's using. Not necessarily our brand. I just happen to show this, but a full intermediate, just like if you were still water fishing for trout, this line that we offer is camo on the weight forward, and then it's kind of dark olive green on the back, but some companies do full camo, some do opaque, but full intermediate is kind of like your main standard line that most people out in Tidewater are doing. Then this is kind of a more modern rendition of the shooting tapers. What it is it literally goes intermediate, sink 2, sink 3, and it would be like your deeper water variable. I would say this is your second most important line nowadays if you do not have the sinking shooting tapers. The unfortunate screwy thing right now, everyone's probably aware of like how tight inventory is for all these companies out there. I've had these ordered in 10 weight for like 2 months from Scientific Anglers, and they're just not showing up. I have them at 9 weight at the store, but if somebody wants them, I can't help you right now. So, you know, you'd have to look on eBay or something. But here is a picture of that taper. So intermediate running line. The line I'm talking about goes sink 2, sink 3. There's actually another one I'll mention coming up, and it's intermediate, sink 3, sink 6. I would say that'd be like your big time dredger. So actually, you know what? I have this back here. Let me go back. The leaders. Oh, you know what? Actually, I'm gonna have to talk about it. I just realized I sent out a newsletter from my store and I had the leader length. So here's the deal with the leaders. On like this one right here, type 1, I would run literally like a 9-footer at 20 pounds. So I would do 3 feet, 3 feet, 3 feet. Then this one here, I would go like 2 feet, 2 feet, 3 feet. So you're talking like 4, it's about 7 feet. This one here, I'd literally cut everything about 6 inches. So I go like 1.5 of 30 to 1.5 of 25 to then 2.5 again. And the main rule of thumb I'd say is as I get denser, I'm getting shorter by about a foot. But one big interesting thing about salmon is that you will typically go a little bit longer or a good bit longer than you would for steelhead. Like if I was using a sink tip for steelhead, I probably have a pretty short leader, 3 to 5 feet or so. This right here, you know, I might be running, like I said, 9 feet, 7 feet, 8 feet. So pretty long. Weighted flies help drop it down. So where can we do salmon on the fly? Bays and rivers. In Oregon, I'm going to mention, just because this is my knowledge, some of you probably fish over here, it could be done in any of the bays in Oregon, Tillamook, Nestucca, Nehalem, etc. These are the North Coast bays. Make sure you know your regs, because I'm sure it's like this in Washington. They're changing them by the week, by the, you know, fish run, by the heat of the summer, etc. Right now, the regs, for instance, in Oregon are looking pretty good because the runs are good. So they put like an open fishery for one wild coho, they have hatchery coho, all sorts of good things. So one thing I do literally nowadays, it makes life easy, is I get on Google Earth and satellite view and Tidewaters, and I just drag the mouse around, and I literally, sometimes they take the pictures at low tide. Like all the pictures for Oregon right now are at this incredible low tide. So you can really see like where the holes are in the bays. And then you can find some areas that are near highways, you know, near side roads, and you can actually find some pretty crazy access points that a lot of people would have no idea exist. Many rivers spill into smaller tidewaters and lagoons. So an example of that would be like in Oregon, the Miami, where you have this little creek, and it takes truckloads of rain to barely influence it, and it just goes right into Tillamook Bay. And you can see the mouth of the jetty barely away from there. So from your distance from the salt, it's incredible. Boat really helps. I notice in like a lot of your outings pictures, your guys are showing boats, but reality is not all of us have boats. So, you know, for those of you who don't have boats, get friends with the people that have boats, buy one, or actually do, like I said, drag it around. I do plenty. You're going to see a lot of pictures of me with no boat. So what are we going to do about the fishing for the tide? So some salmon, tidewater, or tidal influence fish are going to be good on like an incoming tide. Some are going to be good on an outgoing tide. Something I've noticed that's really interesting is if you have a big bay, the spots closer to the mouth of the bay are going to typically be best when you have like an incoming tide, because what it does is it actually pushes the bait fish from the ocean in. Like it'll push the candlefish, anchovies, herring, and the fish will follow them. Now, when you get to the way upper bay reaches, if you call it an upper bay, where the rivers are coming in, a lot of those areas are going to be better on low tides. And then as far as best fishing, maybe outgoing, but also that incoming before you get the rain. So kind of a lot of information, but right now pre-rain, a big, you know, really low tide with an incoming high far up bay could push that salt water in, bring the bait in, trigger up the bay, fish. Soon as it rains in a few days from now, that's going to change, because then it's going to become more fresh water in there. And then I would say you're going to want to have a high tide in the nighttime going into a really low tide right at sunrise or in the morning. And that's going to basically, you know, condense the fish into the low tide zone. So you have all these fish spread out at high, and then they basically are going to get condensed in. So what I do as an example, if I'm going to fish the Salmon River in Oregon, I just type in Cascade tide or Cascade head tides if I'm near the ocean. If I'm in Otis, which is kind of tidal zone boundary, I'll type in Salmon River tides Otis, Oregon, and you'll see different readings. A lot of times the further up bay areas are going to be later delayed by half hour, hour, hour and a half or so. So how do we have success? So positioning yourself to swing, strip a fly off a drop-off is a major success. So if I'm in a boat I'm going to look for shallow water right under my boat, and I'm going to have it so maybe my boat is parked on the edge where it's going to drop right off into the deeps. If I'm weighted, same thing. I'm going to wade, so I'm standing maybe thigh waist deep, and right, you know, a few steps in front of me, it's just going to drop off into the hole. You know, if you turn tidewater or rivers into a, you know, rivery system, because in tidewaters, you're going to even have this, well, you'll have like the shallow uplift at the back of a pool. Fish will hold there as much as the front drop offs of the pools. And then another big success rate is changing the sink rate of your fly to match the tidal currents or the depth. So I've had where I'm fishing with friends and they're all using an intermediate and everyone's just fishing and fishing. And then I just throw on like a type two line and all of a sudden fish on, 20 minutes later fish on. And I'm thinking you guys should change your lines. And they're all sitting there going, what are you doing? And I'm like fishing a deeper line, guys. So, you know, with that, basically now we're going to start changing things up. I'm going to have some video clips and showing some of these techniques and going a little bit in more in depth. So first we're gonna kind of go into Chinook in the freshwater. There's still a strong fish. They'll have an empty stomach from days to weeks. They're more likely to take egg patterns as opposed to like a clouser minnow, for instance, but they'll also take leech patterns or comet style flies. I would call these like upriver flies. For Chinook salmon and rivers, we have stripping and swinging fly technique.
Ryan, I hate to interrupt you, but you got off. I put something in the chat window. When you're talking tidewater, are you actually talking about the lower bay or like the tributaries that are affected by the
influx? It could be actually even some of the areas in rivers where maybe low tide's fresh, but at high, it could be flooded in to upper bays.
Oregon, the trash river below the hospital hole.
Yeah, even like, so like 101 down, I would say, for the Trask.
Okay.
Yeah, Wilson, like Sully Smith down, Kilchis, like 101 down, then the Stucca, Woods down, if anyone's familiar with those. As far as the swinging stripping flies, and again, relate this to rivers or tide when I'm saying eddies or pool type holes, and present it with a classic wet fly swing and strip back, cast, sink down, strip back slowly again. So the reason I say stripping and swinging flies is a lot of these spots, if I strictly just threw it out and went to swing it, it will actually swing so slowly that the fly will just sink to the bottom and just stop swinging. You know, almost like if you look at my arm, it would go like, and just stop. So when you put a strip onto it, you're, I would say keeping that swing tight and making it swing, as weird as it sounds. It's really bizarre. So pink or chartreuse dominated patterns are going to be the best for pools and eddies. And that statement there of referring to fresh can be leeches, egg sucking leeches, comet style flies or bosses. So this part here, I'm kind of talking more about river or even if the fish were just sitting in tidewater coloring up. But right as I mentioned there, clousers if the fish are chrome bright and just out of the salt. So if the fish are booking up river and they're still fresh and chrome, they're going to act like tidewater fish even if they're in the freshwater. This right here would be an example of swinging, stripping, and actually a hookup. The strip is really slow. Later on, I'll have a slide where you're gonna see hands pulling the line, but it's not at all a brown trout strip, I would say. It's a very slow, drawn out strip.
Is this kind of like a gear fisherman using a twitching jig?
No, actually, really just slow strip where when you watch the fly, it's almost like going like that, if anyone is watching my little frame there. But it really, like I said, just kind of enhances the fact that it can't really swing because it's too slow. Like this spot here was just like an eddy. And so if I was like try to swing, it would just sink to the bottom and do nothing. Whoops. Okay, so now going to the other sort of river fishing method, dead drifting flies. Literally, it'd just be like you're nymphing for trout, except you're using big rods and, you know, egg patterns or leech flies. The big key, somebody way earlier asked me what kind of water. So found in bottlenecks or tight constricted like trap spots due to obstructions in the rivers. Best fish with dead drifted fly, a tight line or indicator in the bottlenecks, travel lanes, or constricted obstructions. I've just found once the fish are kind of in the move up the river, they usually don't want to bite a strip swung fly as well as a dead drifted fly. We all want to get them swinging, but unfortunately, sometimes the statistics just call for success. So pink, chartreuse, or orange leeches, comets, boss patterns, egg sucking leeches, egg patterns work best for dead drifting for Chinook. And again, as I said earlier, a clouser can work. I've seen some people tie like jiggy ones and dead drift them, even in tidewater, as weird as it sounds. And here's gonna be a little video clip. So this spot here, what's interesting about it is it's very narrow. If you just go downstream, the river is about four times wider. But up here, you can see how narrow it is. So every single fish in the river has to go right through that little like 8 foot wide ribbon right there. So you just throw your, you know, indicator up here, dead drift it down and fish on every so many casts. Here's going to be another example. So a future slide is going to show this spot from the right bank, but you see how wide that is right there? This is, you know, feet wide, and from here to there, it's probably waist to chest deep. So it's like a little bathtub, and it gets so loaded with fish that I had a day in here on a Halloween years ago where my friend and I had fish on for like 8 hours of the day, chrome bright cohos, walk up, take a cast or two, fish on, just rock it out of there into the backing all day long. It was amazing. So this little video clip is going to show the exact same spot I just showed you, but what it looks like from the bank side. There's another slab down here and this slab here. The water is inches deep all the way to right there, which is where that last picture was taken and somebody's standing on it. This, you know, same guy, but right here, all the fish in here. So, you know, super nonchalant looking area, but, you know, most people would walk right by it and it happens to be an unbelievably productive spot. Here's a, you know, same spot again. And, you know, he just got all sorts of fish hiding in here and take a cast, fish on. Here's, you know, a good looking river fish. They can get a lot brighter, but this is, I would say, a typical good looking river fish. So now we're going to kind of just do the same thing for cohos. We'll talk about them into the rivers. Same kind of drill. They're going to be in eddies or pools. You can present them with a classic wet fly swing. You can strip back or you can cast, sink down and strip back. Cohos are very stereotypically pink, dominated, pink and purple. Chartreuse works really well too, as much as I didn't write that there. They can be found in bottlenecks or obstructions. That last spot I showed, so we were Chinook fishing in the days of that picture, but coming up, you'll see pictures of the same thing for coho. Best fished with dead drifted or tight line method in those bottlenecks. And again, pink leech patterns or egg patterns work best. So there's gonna be a quick video clip of the one spot you saw. Actually, this is like a swing and strip fish first. This one took like a streamer. This is the Nestucca River. Now here's that same spot as earlier, the same pinch up in the top of that spot right up there. I caught this one, I remember, high sticking. I had a leech on and I was like Euro nymphing with a pink leech. I feel like this one actually got off from what I remember because it just rolled too many times. Yeah, gets off right there. Oh no, it's still on. I thought it got off. I remember it does get off there.
Brian, question. You were on an Estuca. Was that above woods?
That was a colored up coho on an Estuca. Oh wait, were you saying above woods? That was first bridge to farmers. First to farmers on that one. We're about to get near Highway 101 in that video clip. Yeah, there it got off.
Looks like you were using pontoon boats to float it.
That was a big pontoon, yeah, because the water was like so shallow, we had to drag the boat through a couple areas. But so shallow, it wasn't dangerous, I would say. It was the other way around. Just had to physically yank it through some of the ripples. So here's one with indicator. And we were literally, you know, throwing it up here, drifting down. You've seen this spot about five times now. Unfortunate reality of this spot is we can't get into it anymore because it was taken over by Weyerhaeuser. And it's on the North Fork in the Nehalem below the hatchery. You have to buy a permit now. So, but it was on the North Fork in the Nehalem below the hatchery here.
We're about 40 minutes in now, Brian. I've done where you are pace-wise. Are we okay?
Funny, somehow the audio on this video is ahead of where the video is. It's having a weird moment. Right there. All right. All right, so now this is anybody in this group a member of the Oregon Fishing Club? Well, if anyone is, this is the Otis Salmon property, just to let you know, because it's a great property. And here, I'm targeting Chinook in theory, but I get this coho. And what I did was I literally cast it about in that direction that the line is pointing in. And then this spot here happens to be so shallow that immediately when it lands, I'm starting to strip. Otherwise, I would hang up in the bottom or snag a fish, actually, in this day. But what's neat is you see I strip until the fish is just on. You'll all see me flinch even, where I almost go, you know, I thought I had one. Then I just keep on stripping, which is a really good tip, I would say, is strip until the fish is on the end of your line. Because I felt that, you know, a grab, and I just didn't fail it pan out, and I kept on going. And you know, right when I'm about to give up, fish kicks on. I'm already, you know, about to probably see my fly, and then all of a sudden I'm like, wow, I got a fish on here. It kind of committed suicide on my line by luck. But this fish, the funny thing is it takes a chartreuse and white clouser, so that is stereotypically like your parachute atoms for Chinook fly fishing, but obviously the coho take it too, because you'll see this fish come into the net any second. Come on. Uh-oh. Hopefully it's not. I'm going to kill the slide and get, yeah, I seem like I didn't want to let it freeze. So that spot earlier that I showed you from the other angle, this is the same spot again, where there was that little like bathtub. This is the day I talked about earlier. I said a friend of mine and I had fish on for about 8 hours of the day. They all looked like that right there. It was unbelievable. Like we just would walk up, take a cast, fish on, fight it, the other guy'd go all day like that. One of the best days ever.
Ryan, do you find that the coho and then the chum will move a lot farther for a fly than the Chinook?
Stereotypically, but you know, I've seen Chinook, like when I'm going to pull my fly out of the water and be like, I just missed one, you know, where you'll see one follow it to take your fly out of the water. But yeah, I think you are correct saying that. I mean, you could catch a chum or a Chinook, I think, in Oregon, but in Alaska they do it, you know, in Washington, but in Alaska they do it on poppers. I'm sure you can do it if you tried it. I'm going to try it this fall, put it that way. We've been talking about it. So this is a just gorgeous chrome bright silver right here. Just wanted to share that. But so now we're going to go over chum in rivers. They could be in eddies or pool type holes. Present with a classic wet fly string and strip back. That same kind of technique works for all salmon. It's actually, as a matter of fact, there's some spots where you can catch, like on the kilches, you can catch a chum, coho, or a Chinook in the same day doing the same everything. Fly should be shallower than the fish's holding depth. This is really important. So if you see a pack of fish, like if you're in a boat and you look down, you want to be stripping your fly above their backs and not through the fish. If you strip it through them, you're going to snag them. And if you strip it above them, they're going to rise up, eat it. And when I mean above them, I'm talking just over their backs. But you do not want to have to pull your fly into the fish. Pink or chartreuse dominated patterns are the ticket. And anything from comets to leeches. I don't know if anyone's heard of a fly called a chum turd. It's like the easiest thing to tie. I would suggest look it up. You can fish it stripped, swinged, or dead drift. And it's a 5 minute to tie, if that. Can be found in bottlenecks or obstructions. And best fished when they're in the river with a dead drift in those bottlenecks. So pools, swing, strip, and then bottlenecks, dead drift. And pink or chartreuse patterns or egg patterns work the best for the dead drifting as well. Here's a quick clip. I'm going to probably kill this video as it goes because it's kind of long and I have some good stuff coming up. So let me get this one started. Whoops. Hold on. Went too fast. Nope. Come on. Where is there? Yeah. This is the Miami right here. There's a spot that you can access where there's a dairy farmer called the Moss Creek Bridge. As of last year, you can access it. A few years ago, you couldn't. Then they reallowed access last year. It's about a mile of bank with various types of water. There's a bridge upstream that you can swing for them, which is really fun. In this case, I'm setting my egg pattern and weight of to dredge it down over the fish too. Same thing, about 6 inches above the fish. So when they rise up and eat it, it's guaranteed. You know, there was probably in upwards of, you know, 50 fish holding at the head of this pool right over here. And it was crazy on this day. No one out too. You see that sea lice right there? It's pretty wild. All right, I'm gonna actually kill this one because there's just a lot of that footage.
Yeah, Brian, we're at about 50 minutes now, so we should be closing in.
Okay, yeah, that's, I'm right about, oops.
Okay.
Hold on, I actually backslid. Okay, so yeah, this is actually the final couple here. All right, so this is gonna be Tidewater Chinook to kind of finish it out. Best fish where your channels are gonna constrict the fish. Classic wet fly string, a swing, strip back slowly. Here's a great analogy. It's more like lake fishing for trout than swing for steelhead. They eat on the strip more than the swing. So a lot of people, you know, would relate it to swinging for steelhead, but that funny analogy I think is really important. The fly should be presented shallower in the fish's holding depth. That has to do with that above their back thing. Clouser minnows to me are what it's all about. I use these other flies, but I personally will fish clousers, and clousers, and just change the colors and sizes and weights of them. I just have that much confidence in one. Whoops, come on. Okay, here is a really nice, well-rounded fly box. So I thought it's a good one to show. All sorts of good colors in there for, I would even say, you know, more than Chinook, but this was a Chinook box. Here's going to be the strip. So just pay attention to the arms moving on this.
You know, what do you mean? I don't know, like I, so what I've been doing best on in here is just like a clear intermediate, you know? Yeah. So, and I, my flies have like, I'm using a clouser with like little dumbo eyes, but light ones, you know?
All the fish too have had inflated swim bladders.
So I purposely kept the audio on there. I think it's kind of neat to hear him talking, and you could hear him say full intermediate, and you know, it's this big deep pool and talking about the weight of his flies. So here's just going to be kind of the finale, a couple little video clips and we'll be done. This is a really nice fish from the Nestucca Bay. I took a friend out and he was using my 8-weight switch rod and kind of casting it like beach casting, basically. So just enabling it to bomb out big casts. So we were over there, but we pulled out of that hog line to fight the fish. But everyone's anchored right on the edge of a hole, basically. I'm telling him there to have the bottom of his rod not bent behind his shoulder, because I've seen many a rods blow up on landing mode where you get those fish close in, you want to have your butt section more parallel to the water. Very important for fighting these big fish. And as someone stated earlier, don't put your hand in the graphite. Thank you. That was his first one, so he just probably quit after that, you know. Okay, then there's literally about a minute or so left, but this part I just want to show really important. This is going to be, you're going to see a video of this spot, but standing on the log, firing a cast here, kind of swings around and then strip it up through this gut, and all the fish are hanging in this gut right here. So you're going to see this coming up right now. You know, just like I mentioned, cast down and across, let it swing around. And once the fly is above the slot, strip it back with long, slow pulls. You're going to see it right here. The cast is going to land right in that corner. This is kind of that, you know, where I was pointing to. And then it's going to swing in front of a stump. And then I'm going to pull it up. I'm standing on a log right now, and right in front of me is a deep slot. You can kind of see the line. The problem is a little bit of drops on the camera lens here, but there's the line. Right now, starting to strip it back.
You seem to find a lot of water where you aren't competing with your fishermen.
I know, and you know, it's funny is I would be honest with you guys and tell you there's like 100 people the next pull up right upstream of me in this video. Isn't that weird? So yeah, that's basically it, the presentation. Here's actually that fish that just happens in that spot right here. So this is the fish right here, just to finish it up. There's the fish. And there's the log, so. This is the log, and right here's that slot. There's that same spot.
So how much time on the water did it take to discover that spot?
Oh, it's like, I would be honest with you and tell you, the first, so this is the, six is right here, and the first time I ever went there, I just walked right to the spot, and there was like 100 people standing elbow to elbow. But what's weird about this day is kind of just past, you know, back behind here, there's literally like 15 people, and just the river's just bent enough where they can't see us. And it was really funny because, you know, nonstop action, and they had no idea, although they were probably catching them too up there. But what's weird is I've been out here where there's so many people, it's scary. And then I've been out here where there's nobody, you know, it just is really weird. But a lot of times salmon have crowds, and sometimes they leave. Like I was with my wife one day and we were fishing with a lot of people, and then everybody left. And then when everyone left, all of a sudden, like a surge of like several hundred fish came in, and we had one of the most remarkable sessions of our lives. It was unbelievable. And there were tourists around, and they were like, is this normal? And we're like, no, this is not normal. There's like a phenomenon you're witnessing now, you know. And they were just like, wow, you two people are the only people. And we're like, yeah, hours ago there was like 50 people out here. So persistence pays, I guess, you know. But anyone have any questions or anything? I actually killed the volume on purpose, so if you guys want to ask any questions or anything.
Well, of the rivers that you are fishing, how much of it has access for wading?
So for instance, here there's like a state park with just miles, and a lot of it's just how far you want to walk. Like this place here, you have to walk like a mile from your car, but it's through a grassy field. At the mouth of the elk, you have to walk like 2 miles, but some people drive. I have some spots that I fish off Tillamook Bay where I park the car and just walk like 100 feet from the car. The Alsea River, which is some of those clips earlier, which is kind of far from our area. When I lived in Eugene, I fished a lot, but there was like like an hour's worth of public access you can drive on, you know. And then like if I think of Tillamook Bay, the lower Wilson has pretty good access. The lower Trask has pretty good access. Tillamook Bay has pretty decent access. You know, if you don't have a boat, there's a few spots that you can fish, actually. I haven't really messed with Nehalem Bay too much, to be honest with you. The Nestucca Bay, there's both bank and walk-in, depending on the upper tidewater has a lot better of bank access. Lower tidewater is better of a boat. But I've walked into the mouth. If you look on Google Earth, you could see a way to get into the mouth from the south side. So really neat stuff, you know, as far as, like I said, unfortunately, I don't have too much experience in Washington to chime in on your guys' neck of the woods, but I do a lot of fishing on foot, to be honest, just because a lot of times, I'm sure a lot of you guys have, I have a kid, so I'm restricted on my time, so, you know, a lot of times I have to time it so I could go for, you know, 4 hours in the afternoon or right at sunrise to, you know, 10 a.m. or so. So, you know, a lot of times I just bank access, you know, and I don't know if, like I said, if anybody's in the OFC, that has some really good access. If anyone's in the Oregon Fishing Club, there's some phenomenal access for salmon on some of these tidal waters and lower rivers.
So would you say, I mean, as a rule, it seems like weekends are crowded. Weekdays, you get the locals that fish around their work schedule, yeah. And then you get a few people fishing rivers that aren't locals that will fish the rest of the time slots.
Yeah, no, the one unfortunate thing about salmon is it is something that attracts a lot of people. It does, but also, yeah, like, you know, right now, today, if you put a boat in on the Tillamook Bay, I'm sure you're going to see a lot of people, but, you know, or that clip from the Nestucca Bay, I mean, you guys saw probably 20 boats in the background, but reality is there's quite a bit of good camaraderie out there. When I fish this area and the video here, this could get really crowded here too. Like, this is actually the Elk Mouth here. There's a ton of people that'll be fishing in this area here, right? Like, I don't know how, but just this video ended on the, oh, actually I didn't realize I had this playing. Yeah, so this is all the Elk River mouth here. Let's see if there's any clips of people. Yeah, there's a lot of people here, put it that way. Like, I don't know if you could see if I had this video just running in the background, but there's probably 50 people fishing. The irony of this day was that my wife, me and this other guy were the only three fly fishing, and we were upstream of everybody, or up lagoon, and we were the only people hooking anything all day long. We were hooking fish all day long and handing the fly rod off to some of the gear guys after a while. It was that crazy. So yeah, you see all the people in the background there. I'm not exaggerating saying we were handing it off too. That's how crazy it was. So the weird thing about tidewater fishing, I find, is when it goes stale for the conventional anglers, it's usually good for flies. Like, when the conventional people think the water's low, that's when fly fishing shines, typically.
Brian, we're over an hour now.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
I have shut down, but I think for people that have questions, you know Brian now, and you probably have questions that you didn't even think to have before, and we've got a lot of from you tonight. So go see him. You know who to look for at the Lake Oswego Orbis store. And I know I've got some things I want to ask, but I'll come over and talk awesome. With you there and ask about them.
Yeah. Yeah. It's Chris, a lot of info.
Chris, I'd like to chime in here on what Brian is saying. This is Al Wood. I was in Alaska fishing, and that strip session or strip style that you had given with the clousers, and it's Steve Ferrer's hair was used on the clousers, was exceptional for the cohos. And that's awesome. And in low, slow water was awesome. And that's how we caught them up there. So I can,
and they're really easy to tie with that hair too.
Yeah. It's really, really good stuff. Very tough and really good movement on it.
Yeah.
Thank
good.
You.
Good reinforcement on it.
Yeah. Thanks for chiming that in, 'cause I love that fiber.
Yeah. All right. Well, thank you, Brian.
Yeah, thank you, too. Very much appreciate the invite.
Okay, we appreciate it. So.
Yeah, awesome. Yep.
Thank okay. you, Brian. And, you, I'll Bart. Be over to get some information, and I'll be bringing my wallet too. So that'll
cool. And, well, thank you guys again. I really appreciate the invite and participating with you guys.
Absolutely. Great presentation. Great presentation.
Thank you.
So, thank you everyone for joining us tonight. I guess just sort of the recap, if you've got any ideas about trips for next year, make sure you get a hold of Michael and let him know where you think we might hold a club trip next year. And especially if you're going to want to be a fish master, we are looking for new folks to step up to be a fish master. If you're interested in serving on the board, send me an email. I've actually gotten a couple emails during the presentation, so thank you. Send more if you have an interest. Encourage your other members to attend next month. Chris, what's our presentation next month?
What we're going to have there are some of the guys from, at least one from Pacific Corps, and they're going to explain what's going on there on the North Fork, where they're moving some of the salmon up above into the upper North Fork, and kind of what's the results been. They want to know what we may have seen up there too with the salmon.
Outstanding. Yep, I'd be very interested in that too, to see what the future is going to hold for that system. Okay, everybody, have a great time. Go out there, make your own fishing report, and we'll hear back next month. I'm going to go out and make mine, and so we'll report back next month and tight lines. We'll see you later. Thanks for joining. All right.
Bye.
Thanks, Brian. Thanks, Chris. Good job.